This is the story of the Lorax. At the far end of town, where the grickle grass grows, and the wind smells slow and sour when it blows, and no birds ever sing excepting old crows, is the street of the lifted Lorax. And deep in the grickle grass, some people say, if you look deep enough, you can still see today where the Lorax once stood, just as long as it could before somebody lifted the Lorax away. What was the Lorax? And why was it there? And why was it lifted and taken somewhere? From the far end of town where the grickle grass grows. The old Onceler still lives here. Ask him, he knows. You won't see the Onceler. Don't knock at his door. He stays in his lurkin on top of his store. He lurks in his lurkin cold under the roof, where he makes his own clothes out of miff-muffered moof. And on special dark midnights in August, he peeks out of the shutters, and sometimes he speaks and tells you how the Lorax was lifted away. He'll tell you, perhaps, if you're willing to pay. On the end of a rope, he lets down a tin pail, and you have to toss in 15 cents and a nail, and the shell of a great, great, great grandfather snail. Then he pulls up the pail, makes a most careful count to see if you've paid him the proper amount. Then he hides what you paid him away in his snuff, his secret strange hole in his groovulous glove. Then he grunts, I will call you by whisper my phone, for the secrets I tell you are for your ears alone. Slup, down slups the whisper my phone to your ear, and the old Onceler's whispers are not very clear. Since they have to come down through a snurgly hose, and he sounds as if he had smallish bees up his nose. Now I'll tell you, he says, with his teeth sounding gray, how the Lorax got lifted and taken away. It all started way back, such a long, long time back. Way back in the days when the grass was still green, and the pond was still wet, and the clouds were still clean, and the song of the Swami swans ran out in space. One morning I came to this glorious place, and I first saw the trees, the truffula trees, the bright colored tufts of the truffula trees, mile after mile in the fresh morning breeze. And under the trees I saw brown barbalutes frisking about in their barbalut suits, as they sang, as they played in the shade in the truffula fruits. From the ripulous pond came the comfortable sound of the humming fish humming while splashing around. But those truffula trees. All my life I'd been searching for trees such as these. The touch of their tufts was much softer than silk, and they had the sweet smell of fresh butterfly milk. I felt a great leaping of joy in my heart. I knew just what I wanted to do. I unloaded my cart. In no time at all, I had built a small shop. Then I chopped down a truffula tree with one chop. I took the soft tuft and I knitted a thneed. The instant I'd finished, I heard a glump. I looked. I saw something pop out of the stump of the tree I'd chopped down. It was sort of a man. Describe him? That's hard. I don't know if I can. He was shortish and oldish and brownish and mossy, and he spoke with a voice that was sharp and bossy. Mister, he said with a sawdusty sneeze, I am the Lorax. I speak for the trees. I speak for the trees. I speak for the trees, for the trees have no tongues. And I'm asking you, sir, at the tip of my lung. He was very upset, and he shouted and puffed, what's that thing you've made out of my truffula tuft? Look, Lorax, I said, There's no cause for alarm. I chopped down just one tree. I am doing no harm. I'm being quite useful. This thing is a thneed. A thneed's a fine something that all people need. It's a shirt, it's a sock, it's a glove, it's a hat. But it has other uses. Yes, far beyond that. You can use it for carpets, for pillows, for sheets, or curtains, or covers for bicycle seats, the Lorax said. Sir, you are crazy with greed. There is no one on earth who would buy that fool thneed. But the very next minute, I proved he was wrong, for just at that minute, a chap came along, and he thought that the thneed I had knitted was great. He happily bought it for $3.98. I laughed at the Lorax. You poor, stupid guy. You can never tell what the people will buy. I repeat, cried the Lorax, I speak for the trees. I'm busy, I told him. Shut up, if you please. I rushed across the room, and in no time at all, built a radio phone. I put in a quick call. I called all my brothers and uncles and aunts, and I said, listen here, here's a wonderful chance for the whole Wunsler family to get mighty rich. Get over here fast. Take the road to North Nitch. Turn left at Weehawken, sharp right at South Stitch. And in no time at all, in the factory I built, the whole Wunsler family was working full tilt. We were all knitting thneeds, just as busy as bees, to the sound of the chopping of truffula trees. Then, baby, oh baby, how my business did grow. Now chopping one tree at a time was too slow. So I quickly invented my super ace hacker, which whacked off 4 truffula trees at one smacker. We were making thneeds 4 times as fast as before, and that Lorax, he didn't show up anymore. But the next week he knocked on my new office door. He snapped, I'm the Lorax who speaks for the trees, which you seem to be chopping as fast as you please. But I'm also in charge of the brown barbalutes, who played in the shade in their barbalut suits and happily lived eating truffula fruits. Now, thanks to your hacking my trees to the ground, there's not enough truffula fruit to go around. And my poor barbalutes are all getting the crummies because they have gas and no food in their tummies. They love living here, but I can't let them stay. They'll have to find food, and I hope that they may. Good luck, boys, he cried, and he sent them away. I, the Wunsler, felt sad as I watched them all go. But business is business, and business must grow. Regardless of crummies and tummies, you know. I meant no harm, I most truly did not, but had to grow bigger, so bigger I got. I biggered my factory, I biggered my roads, I biggered my wagons, I biggered the loads of the thneeds I shipped out. I was shipping them forth to the south, to the east, to the west, to the north. I went right on biggering, selling more thneeds, and I biggered my money, which everyone needs. Then again he came back. I was fixing some pipes when that old nuisance Lorax came back with more gripes. I am the Lorax, he coughed and he whiffed. He sneezed and he snuffled, he snarled, he sniffed. Wunsler, he cried with a cruffulous croak, Wunsler, you're making such a smogulous smoke. My poor swami swans, why they can't sing a note. No one can sing who has smog in their throat. And so, said the Lorax, please pardon my cough. They cannot live here, so I'm sending them off. Where will they go? I don't hopefully know. They may have to fly for a month or a year to escape from the smog you smogged up around here. What's more, snapped the Lorax, his dander was up, let me say a few words about glippity-glup. Your machinery chugs on day, night, without stop, making glippity-glup, and also sloppity-slop. And what do you do with this leftover goo? I'll show you, you dirty old onceler man, you. You're glumping the pond where the humming fish hummed. No more can they hum, for their gills are all gummed. So I'm sending them off. Oh, their future is dreary. They'll walk on their fins and get woefully weary in search of some water that isn't so smeary. I hear things are just as bad up in Lake Erie. And then I got mad. I got terribly mad. I yelled at the Lorax, "Now listen here, Dad. All you do is yap and yap and say bad, bad, bad. Well, I have my rights, sir, and I'm telling you, I intend to go on doing just what I do. And for your information, you Lorax, I'm figuring on biggering and biggering and biggering and biggering. Turning more truffula trees into thneeds, which everyone needs." And at that very moment, we heard a loud whack. From outside in the fields came a sickening snack of an axe on a tree. Then we heard the tree fall, the very last truffula tree of them all. No more trees, no more thneeds, no more work to be done. So in no time, my uncles and aunts and everyone all waved me goodbye. They jumped into my cars and drove away under the smoke-smothered stars. Now all that was left neath the bad-smelling sky was my big empty factory and I. The Lorax said nothing, just gave me a very sad, sad backward glance. And he lifted himself by the seat of his pants. And I'll never forget the grim look on his face when he heisted himself and took leave of this place. Through a hole in the smog without leaving a trace. And all that the Lorax left here in the mess was a small pile of rocks with the one word, unless. Whatever that meant, well, I just couldn't guess. That was long, long ago. But each day since that day, I've sat here and worried away. Through the years, while my buildings have fallen apart, I've worried about it with all my heart. But now, says the onceler, now that you're here, the word of the Lorax seems perfectly clear. Unless someone like you cares a whole awful lot, nothing is going to get better. It's not. So, catch, calls the onceler. He let something fall. It's a truffula seed. It's the last one of all. You're in charge of the last of the truffula seeds. And truffula trees are what everyone needs. Plant a new truffula. Treat it with care. Give it clean water and feed it fresh air. Grow a forest. Protect it from axes that hack. Then the Lorax and all of his friends may come back. Thank you so much for joining us for Coronavirus Storytime. This is the story of the Lorax.